Hey guys, welcome to Practical Home Projects. So before you get started on your big flooring project, you need to make sure that your subfloor is sufficiently prepped. So there's three major steps you need to go through before you can install your final flooring. So the first is to check your subfloor to make sure that it doesn't have any rot or any sort of structural issues with it. So you're going to look for holes, you're going to look for rotten spots, and just kind of visually inspect it. The second thing you're going to want to do is get rid of any squeaks. So as you're replacing the floor is the best time to get rid of any squeaking spots. So we'll kind of go over how to do that. And then the third thing you're going to want to do is to make sure it's as level as you can possibly get it. Different types of flooring have different levels of tolerance for how smooth that topography needs to be. But in general, you don't want any major dips or major high spots, so you're going to try to level that out the best you can. So we're going to get started and show you some examples with our kitchen. There's a couple of reasons that you might have an inconsistent subfloor. One of them is the shifting of the house. So our house is maybe 60 years old, so I'm sure there's a little bit of that. Another one could be that in the initial installation, they didn't use perfectly flat joists. And the fourth one is, of course, some sort of damage over time. Either the wood's been compromised via mold or water damage, or it could have just been sawed through, or it could just be old and kind of on its way out. Any of those cases could require further reinforcement, or it could be possible just to kind of stiffen up the floor as is. So that's what we need to investigate before we get started.
We noticed that there's a little bit of floor deflection right here. Once we put our final LVP down, we don't want to have any movement in that flooring, so we need to be able to secure this before we get started. I noticed that there's a little bit of mold down here on the subfloor in the crawl space. This is due to a refrigerator leak that was there before we arrived, and we had fixed that leak, and this is actually totally dry. But I'm going to treat this with a chemical called concrobium. This will kill any active mold as well as encapsulate mold spores, so those spores will not foster and create new mold growth in the future. Apply the solution in a low humidity environment and let it sit for at least 12 hours before proceeding.
So I went ahead and cut these 10 inch wide boards to just the width of the cavity, which is about 14 inches. So the idea is that I will prop those up there, and then I cut these little 2x2s, and that these are going to be kind of holding it in place. So I went ahead and already pre-drilled them, put some 2.5 inch exterior screws in. So all I have to do is press it up there, and then these will act as sort of a ledge. So I'll hold the boards, and I decided to do a separate set for every board just to make sure it could be nice and tight instead of it possibly having some loose spots and some of the boards not supporting it fully. I'm going to go ahead and hop in this crawl space and get these installed.
After letting the disinfectant solution dry overnight, we went ahead and installed these three sets of boards. You can see I left about 1.5 inch expansion gap between each one of them, and then I installed them as tightly to the subfloor as possible so that there should be no movement in the future. This is a pretty sturdy solution, so even if that subfloor is a little bit compromised, these boards should be able to support it in the future. Just above where we installed those boards, it's much more solid. I can still feel just a little bit of movement, and that's mostly due to this finished flooring actually lifting off of the subfloor. I'm going to go ahead and remedy that by pre-drilling a couple holes along this hardwood flooring, and then I'm going to install some deck screws. So those are going to go straight through the hardwood floor, the subfloor, and hopefully even attach the joist below.
So if you notice you have a squeaking sound in your room, then before you lay the flooring is the best time to deal with it. And it's surprisingly simple to fix. So we know we have joists running this way, and then we noticed there was a squeaking sound right around this area. All we had to do is kind of keep pressing our foot down until we found the center of the squeaky noise. And then I drilled a pilot hole with my smallest bit to see if I could find the joist. And surprisingly, I was only about an inch off on my first shot. So the first one, I drilled the hole, I stuck a piece of wire down to see if I hit the joist. I didn't, I went over about an inch, and then I realized I hit the joist. So I put a screw down there, and magically the squeaking noise stopped. And I went ahead and put another screw kind of next to that as well, spaced maybe 2 or 3 inches apart. So now this spot no longer has any squeak to it. And if you know, the reason the squeaking happens is because your floorboard is just a little bit loose off the joist, so that squeak could be wood on wood, or it could be some nails or screws that you had that were pretty old that are kind of rubbing on the wood that are making that noise.
Before using the thin set, we need to do a little bit of prep work. So I'm going to go ahead and get rid of those nails, screws, and any other protrusions sticking out of the flooring. And I'm going to wipe off all the dust on the floor just because I don't want that mixing in with our compound.
So next we're going to mix up our batch of thin set. So the most important thing is to follow the instructions on your package.
If you're doing a larger batch, I definitely recommend using a paddle mixer and maybe even a designated mixing tool. However, we're doing a really small amount, so I've actually just got a 1 gallon bucket from some old drywall mix and a wood stick, essentially, a piece of 1x1 to help me stir it up. When you do this mixing, you're definitely going to use water first. If you add the powder first, then when you pour the water in, you're gonna have dust everywhere. So put water in first, which means you kind of have to have an idea of how much material you're gonna use. So my package says use about 6 quarts for this entire bag. So I'm gonna use about 3/4 of 1 quart, and that should give me approximately half of this 1 gallon bucket full of final mixture. So I've already got my water measured out. Whenever you do this project, you wanna be as close to room temperature as possible. So even if it's a little bit cold outside, I make sure to warm the water up ahead of time. And you absolutely cannot use this stuff if you're below 40 degrees or above 95 degrees. So I'm gonna go ahead and put my respirator on ahead of time. This is similar to drywall dust in that it's a very, very fine particle that will get into your lungs and cause some damage. Safety glasses too.
And we're outside because I don't want this dust going everywhere. And I'm just gonna add a little bit at a time and mix it up. The goal is to get to the consistency of peanut butter. You want it to be thick enough to hold its own, but also not so thick that you can't spread it nice and smooth. All right, so I think we got the appropriate amount of water and powder combinations. I'm gonna go ahead and just make sure I get these lumps out, make sure to scrape the edges, and then we'll let it sit. All right, so this looks good. So now our bag says to let it slake for 5 to 10 minutes. And that's just to let the polymeric compound absorb the water and start the reaction. And at that point, it'll be ready for us to stir it up again and then get working with it.
So now we've let it sit for about 8 to 9 minutes. So I feel like it's thickened up just a little bit. So we're gonna re-stir it. Make sure to get all the edges and corners, just like when you're making brownies. It's pretty much the same consistency, a little bit more workable now. So now let's get into the tools. So just for clarification, this is a floor leveling project. This is not a tile setting project. So you'll notice I'm using a very small groove trowel here. This is not the trowel you would use for tiles. This is just this trowel that I'm using just for the sake of getting a nice smooth surface. This is actually the 1/16 inch groove trowel, and I'm gonna be using the flat edge of it. And then also we have kind of both some vinyl tile and some exposed plywood. So with an impervious surface, kind of like vinyl, you can pretty much just work directly on it. For a surface like plywood, I actually like to pre-moisten it before we apply the thin set. That way the wood doesn't just immediately soak the moisture out of it. If I were to just try to apply the thin set right away, it would actually not adhere very well because it would dry it out too fast and then it wouldn't bond. So I'm gonna go ahead and start trying to level out this little section. I'm just gonna do a little bit at a time because we're obviously doing a very thin coat, and I'm gonna try to work with this flat edge. So just to smooth this out, I'm pretty much just trying to make a nice smooth gradient where those lips are. Obviously, by using a bigger container, it'd be easy just to dip the trowel right down in there, or I could use a sort of transfer trowel. So I'm gonna do this the best I can now, and then if it's still a little rough, I will go back and do another coat later. So an LVP plank specifically say no more than 3/16 of an inch over 8 feet. So I'm really just trying to get rid of any major grooves, but I also have a stick for some larger sections to make sure that we don't have too many low dips or high bumps. And you can see I'm mostly just putting this in places where I'm missing a tile, so it can pretty much smooth over and make up for the absence of tile in that spot. Fortunately, this isn't going to be a surface, so for little tiny imperfections like that, I'm just going to ignore them because the LVP will float over that with no problem. I'm mostly worried about ridges like this, so you can see right here we actually have a subfloor edge as well. So I've got about 20 minutes to work with this compound before it starts to harden up too much to be workable. So now the thin set has had at least 24 hours to dry. It's actually been about 2 days, so you can see it's very solid. And I'm gonna kind of go over and do a second coat in a few spots. So right here where we had that lip, there's definitely still a little bit of a dip that needs to be filled in. And then some of these sections are a little bit rough. So before I get started, I'm gonna use this floor scraper. We picked this up for like $6 at a Harbor Freight, and get some of these ridge lines out that I had left.
and then we'll kind of move on to our next step to see what we do with our second coat. Now that we've taken care of sort of those very conspicuous indentions and bumps, I'm going around the room to find if there are any other sort of more gradual deflections in the surface that we need to take care of. So the back of the package for this LVP says that there should be no more than 3/16 of an inch of surface deflection over the course of 10 feet. So this whole kitchen is about 8 feet wide. So I'm actually just using this piece of wood, which is about 4 feet, and I made sure it was straight with a laser. And I'm using this and kind of going around in various places of the kitchen, sampling to see if I can detect either any spots where there's a gap or any spots where the two ends are wobbling. So what I found is actually right here where I'm standing, there's sort of a indention that goes this way, and it's less than about a 16th of an inch. So what I did is I took a couple of LVP planks and I went ahead and clicked them together, and I just kind of walk along this spot right here to tell if I would be able to tell the difference between that small amount of deflection, and I don't feel any movement at all. So I feel pretty confident that we can just install our flooring right over that. However, kind of on the other side of the kitchen, there's a similar sort of dip in the floor, and that one's probably about 3/16 of an inch over the course of just 4 feet, and I think we definitely could tell, so we're going to actually go ahead and fill that in. And the way I was sort of able to identify the boundaries is I was sort of placing this piece of wood along, and then when I got to about here, I noticed that the two ends were wobbling. So I know that there's a ridge line right around here because it sort of pivots on that point, so I just started marking it with blue tape. So I'll know that when I'm kind of doing my fill-in, that this is one end, and then the other end is kind of the lip over there. So in summary, whenever you're preparing your flooring, you need to think about A, getting rid of any rotten or soft spots, and making sure that your floor is totally sound. B, this is the best time to get rid of any squeaks, so go around the entire space and try to find any squeaking points, and then secure your subfloor to the beams. And then 3, of course, making it as level as required for whatever type of your final flooring is. So for us, we chose to use the thin set method. Any sort of cement compound would probably work there. We decided to go that way because it allowed us to have a lot more precision control over kind of where we have thin spots and where we need to pile on a lot. I've also seen people just use something as simple as asphalt shingles and tar paper. Those are easy to stack up to whatever levels you need. However, it might be a little bit more difficult to get that very careful gradient. And then of course, different types of flooring require different levels of precision. If you have, let's say, carpet or something, you might be able to get away with more, whereas tile, you're actually going to have to be very, very close to flat, or else the tiles will bind and crack. So that's pretty much everything for preparing your subfloor for a final floor alignment. Keep tuned for our next video where we're going to show how to install the LVP plank. And then that's pretty much it. So if you guys have any comments or any other suggestions, please put that in the comment area below. And then, of course, like and subscribe if you like what you saw. Thanks, guys.